All right, joining us in the studio this morning, an honor to have him back on Headstart. We have former Chief Justice Hilario Davide Jr. CJ, right. Thank you for coming to the show.
Thank
Appreciate
you also,
it. All right, you're the one who doesn't mince words. You've called the shift to federalism a lethal experiment, a fatal leap, a plunge to death, a leap to hell. Good God, that is scary. I mean, seriously.
I said so November yet of 2017. Before the Makati Business Club and some other business organizations. Now, I am more convinced that it's a real fatal experiment, a leap to hell, a plunge to death. I'll do it the reverse way.
Okay. So. Now, you were part of the 1986 Constitutional Commission. Members today might say, one, you're biased. Number two, you're protective over, of course, the very constitution you took part in. What worries you about this one?
Well, actually, I saw now the final draft
of
this constitution for the Federal Republic of the Philippines drafted by the Consultative Committee. It is worse than what I expected. I thought all along, as earlier announced by Chief Justice Puno, the chairman, that it would focus on federalism alone. What happened was, as it is now appearing in the draft, it is not only on federalism, meaning the breaking up of the Philippines into various federated states, but the entire overhaul of our constitution, including, as a matter of fact, the judiciary.
Okay. Before we, the judiciary, for example, since you've already mentioned it, in the draft federal constitution, there will be four courts that will handle different kinds of cases. And some might ask, what's wrong with that? I mean, the Supreme Court is bogged down with so many cases. We do lack courts. What's wrong with four federal courts?
It would really complicate the issue much more. It is not the solution to the several cases now pending before the Supreme Court. When you have several courts in the federal government, and issues would be varying. So what the situation will be that you'll be complicating more the justice system. But that is not enough. Because in the matter of the appointments, for instance, of the Chief Justice and the Associate Justices, they will have really be politicized and political interferences would be expected.
Okay.
Yes.
But what would the difference?
And then another one.
No, in present day, you do have the president appointing justices of the Supreme Court.
Well, no problem about that, because if you have the JBC. But this time now you don't have the JBC. What you will have will be the president will appoint the Chief Justice and two other justices, because there are only nine, no, instead of 15. So the president will directly appoint the Chief Justice and the two associate justices, and three will be the Commission on Appointments, and the other one by the Federal Constitutional Court.
Okay, so, were you surprised that a former Chief Justice, a colleague of yours, no less than former Chief Justice Puno, advocated for having nine instead of 15, removing the JBC? Did you ask him why?
I did not have a chance to ask him yesterday, because the one who really explained the draft constitution was not the Chief Justice, but one Mr. Generoso.
Yeah, but very clearly you have former Chief Justice Puno, it seems, who was quite or is quite unhappy with the setup of the Supreme Court.
Well, I don't know if he is, but the fact is, the idea of reducing the number was precisely to give way to the creation of three more highest courts, the Constitutional Court, the Administrative Court, and the Electoral Court.
Yeah.
So this is practically a division of labor. Why create other courts with four Chief Justices now, when actually, if you want, you can only increase the number of the membership of the Supreme Court now, and then assign to certain divisions the specific task now, assigned to administrative, electoral, and constitutional.
Okay, all right. Now, moving on to the bigger picture, all right, before we get to the details of the draft itself, how would you describe how the lower house is, or how the lower house wants to push through with charter change? You have the speaker saying things like, we can amend it without the Senate. In fact, the Constitution is clear that just by a majority vote, you drafted that Constitution. You know, why don't you make it clear? What did you guys mean? Why didn't you make it clear? You have congressmen saying, Karen, if you read the 1987 Constitution, they are specific on areas, two-thirds, vote separately, but this one, they just said majority. What did you mean?
Well, actually, what happened was, initially, we did provide for a unicameral assembly. So it only spoke of the Congress. But in the plenary session of the CONCOM of 1986, the proposal of the Committee on Legislative for a unicameral assembly was actually amended.
Okay.
So we came out with a bicameral assembly. Now, if it is a bicameral assembly, meaning the entire Congress now will be composed of two houses, the Senate and the House of Representatives. So if there will be a proposal to amend the Constitution, even if it is very clear in the Constitution, and if it will be a CONAS or a Constituent Assembly, it should be separate voting. So,
but why didn't you write that clearly then? If it was so, if it was written clearly, no one would be arguing like this.
Well, it is very clear by the very nature of a bicameral assembly, even if it is not clearly stated there. What may be clearly stated is if it is joint voting. And so you have a provision on the declaration of martial law and the suspension of the privilege of the writ of habeas corpus, where the Constitution itself mandated a joint session, but voting jointly also.
Okay.
So the presumption is in all other instances, when there will be a situation where it will not provide for joint, it should be separate.
Mm, because you're saying all the other provisions that require joint voting, you guys wrote joint voting. Am I correct?
If it is joint.
Yeah.
But if we do not provide anything about joint or separate, it is to be understood as separate. Because you have two houses, which would complete Congress.
But do other members of the 1986 Constitutional Commission feel that way? Do they have your point of view?
Well, I'm sure that all the members of the CONCOM of 1986 would agree that it should really be separate. So there was only what we call, we failed, probably. The CONCOM failed to exactly stipulate or state in the article on amendment that it should be separate voting.
Okay.
But that was not necessary.
Okay, now do you regret it?
I have no problem about it. Because the Senate had already decided that if it would be a CONAS, it would be separate voting.
Okay, So very quickly, Speaker Alvarez saying we can amend without the Senate.
That's entirely wrong. And I don't know what came into his mind that should be. As a matter of fact, they started to do that already. So they passed a resolution calling for a joint session for a constitutional assembly. And he said that resolution is enough. No, it cannot be a joint without the concurrence of the Senate. So you cannot, one house cannot say that this is joint without the other house being involved.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now, with the upcoming SONA, you have fears of the Speaker calling for a joint, a constituent assembly right at the statement, right at the SONA where both houses are present. Can he do that?
Well, the Senate will object.
But will it matter?
And it will matter a lot because that is really an anomalous situation. It is not allowed. In the first place, if it would be a constituent assembly, it should be a separate resolution.
Mm.
It cannot be done right there when they have a joint session.
But is that clear in the 1987 Constitution?
It is not necessary. It is a matter of procedure. It is a constitutional procedure, as a matter of fact.
Okay. What are they doing wrong now? I mean, you know, all constitutions anywhere in the world is a living, breathing thing. In other words, it can be changed.
Yes, at any time.
At
provided
any time.
There are valid, justifiable, compelling reasons.
Okay.
But now, there is none. What they are trying to do is really to overhaul the entire constitution and introduce to the country a new creature, the federalism, which is not really a fit for the Philippines. We have never experienced about it. And now, as presented in a draft, it would be worse. What will come out would even be a weaker democracy. A weaker because you have certain provisions there, which actually would weaken our democratic institutions.
Like what?
It may be fascism. It may be totalitarianism. I will tell you, the transitory provisions now, as provided for, would create a dictatorship.
Okay.
And there are certain provisions in the new proposal which would really sustain a declaration of martial law, for instance.
Okay, no. Oh. But before you jump to that, I want us to show the amendments. Can we please air that? All right. For the transition, President, it says within 6 months from the ratification of the new constitution, the president, which would be President Duterte, today can call for an election for the transition president and the vice president in tandem. What worries you about that?
What worries about me is this, don't you, Karen, this is now the new provision of Article 22. It was revised. In the original, there was no restriction as to the president's being a candidate for the first presidency under the federal system. Although under our present constitution, he cannot run for any re-election. But if you have a new constitution without a restriction, he can run.
For 2022.
What they did, because it was highly criticized, what they did was to amend the transitory provision now, the Article 22. And this time, although there is a mention of the fact that the incumbent president, whose term will end by 30 June of 2022, cannot run anymore, what they did was to provide for a so-called transition president.
Yeah.
And a transition president is open. There is no prohibition for the incumbent now to run as transition president. And so he can. We do not know how long will it be.
I see.
In the meantime,
I see. I think you should clarify that, because you do have President Duterte coming out to the media and saying, look, no, I don't want to run in 2022 to allay those fears.
So he can run earlier this time.
But you're saying is a transition president can last longer than 2022.
Although the provision provides that the transition government can last only up to June 30, 2022, you have the president having full control, because even a transition president would exercise all the powers of the regular president. So with all the powers given him, including the proclamation of martial law, with an additional ground now, lawless violence, he can prolong.
I see. Because you are not satisfied, I'll read Section 5. This is where Malacanang may debate you. Section 5 does say the transition president and vice president shall be ineligible to run for any public office in the May 2022 elections. That does not convince you.
It will not convince me, because that practically was to avoid the criticism that he cannot run during the May 2022 election, meaning no re-election for him. So what will happen was he will be allowed to run as a transition president, and therefore he will become the first president under the federal system of government.
One might ask you, but what's wrong with that? Isn't this what he campaigned for? Wouldn't he be the perfect person to head it? I'm playing devil's advocate on those who support the president.
It is very an anomalous situation. He was elected until 30 June 2022. Why would he be elected if he will run as transition president midway?
Good
the
point.
Idea is for
finish
him to
22
be able,
first.
Yeah, for him to be able to serve as the first president under the Federal Republic of the Philippines. And that would be a credit. One, he is the last under the United system, and he will be the first under the federal system.
And that's anomalous to you?
Well, to me, because of the many misrepresentations made to the public. He's not willing to run anymore, but he's to run as transition president. But if he'll come out and openly say, I will not run as transition president, he will continue to serve until 30 June 2022. But again, we have to remove now the election of a transition president.
Okay.
Because, if somebody will be elected as a transition president, we will have two presidents.
That's true. Yeah, that is
until
odd.
Until 30 June 2022.
Because you're right. With this provision, they're assuming that President Duterte will win as the transition president.
Well, as I mentioned yesterday during the hearing, that I am so sure that he will run, he will win. Nobody can beat him. But he can, because it is in tandem, he can choose a vice presidential candidate.
Yes, and that's where I'm leading now. This, do you find this manipulative or scheming in some way to, or is there a plan to remove, you feel, the Vice President Lenny Robredo, who he has openly, said that, I will not step down if Lenny takes over?
Well, probably they may not have that in mind, or they could have that in mind. The fact was, they wanted to avoid the criticism that the transition period, as originally provided for, would not ban him from running. So what they did was really just to create a transition president and transition vice president. So probably they were not thinking about Leni, but Leni will be affected there.
Yeah.
If you will have a transition president and a transition vice president, the vice president chosen by the president himself, because they should run in tandem.
Yeah.
So the electoral protest case now in the presidential electoral tribunal, if somebody will run as vice president for the transition vice president, that case would be moot and academic.
Yeah. Does this pave the way for former Senator Bongbong Marcos, who the president has always preferred, is even verbalized it in the past? Would this pave the way for him to be the running mate of President Duterte?
As a matter of fact, I mentioned that that could easily happen. One, to prepare him for the 2022 election. But although in the transitory provisions now as drafted, the president and the transitory president and transitory vice president cannot run under for re-election. I don't think that will come out to pass as is. The lower house might easily amend that, because the proposal now of the consultative commission would still be subject to probable modification if it will be con us.
Okay. Now, you are the most vocal when it comes to the draft federal constitution. And the spokesperson, Ding Generoso, said that you were confused, you lacked logic in your reasoning, and he did say that when you said this new federal constitution is anti-poor, anti-Filipino, pro-dynasty, Ding Generoso said you are confused because you could be referring to the 1987 constitution.
That is why I made a clarification yesterday, because some of the speakers said it is the CONCOM constitution. So I said Generoso might again tell me I am confused. So I'll make a reference. We call this as a CCCOM, and as compared to the 1987 Constitution. CCCOM meaning the Consultative Commission Constitution.
Okay. Oh. All right, but wait, let's be specific. Why do you call this draft federal constitution anti-poor? Just bullet, why is it anti-poor?
You know, Karen.
Okay.
Because of the bloated bureaucracy, I described as a horribly horrendous, bloated, enlarged bureaucracy.
Okay.
Maintaining, therefore, imagine you have 18 states now,
yes,
the federated government.
And you'll have 36 senators.
And then?
Am I right? 18 times 2.
18 times 2.
36
senators.
That is
only for the senators.
Yeah.
But you have 400
plus
for the federal Congress, no? 400 for the House of Representatives. But you have 18 regions now, which will have a National Assembly, which will have also an executive.
Okay.
Not only that, in the entire provision for the judiciary, for instance, several courts have been established. And so what will happen to all of this? It would be creating a large bureaucracy with so many people there, and to maintain alone the national government and the 18 federated regions, and then all the local governments, you need to have a lot of taxes to be imposed.
Yeah.
And who will suffer? It will be the poor people.
Okay.
So it becomes oppressive and unjust.
Yeah, double taxation.
No, it should not only be double.
Okay.
It could be triple. You have the central, you have the federal, and you have the existing local. Now, they claim that double taxation is prohibited under the draft. But that is not the concept of double taxation. There can't be double taxation if the authority taxing it would be entirely different. Here we have three taxing authorities already. And so our taxes might even be tripled or quadrupled. And who will suffer the burden? It will be our people. Not only that, because in the system that we have provided for, you remember before?
Yeah.
Uh-huh. You said a college degree is required.
Yes,
I consider it really as undemocratic, and it is anti-poor.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, because the poor would never have a chance. For instance, if you cannot get a college degree, how can you become a president, for instance? And I said that wisdom, knowledge, and virtues and values are not the monopoly of the educated or the college degree holders.
No.
The poor, even if without any educational qualification, as a matter of fact, that may be much wiser.
So that's quite interesting, is you do disagree with the fact that they put a college degree as a qualification now?
It is only to demonstrate it is anti-poor. Yet, because you know why? That is a qualification for the president, the vice president, senators, congressmen, but not a qualification for the regional assembly people. So if you are a regional assembly assemblyman, or you are a regional governor, or a regional deputy governor, that is not required. Only your ability to read and write.
Okay. All right. But what might ask you, well, CJ, what's wrong with having a president who actually has a college degree when you apply as, let's say, no, honestly speaking, yeah, you apply in a mall or a retail or a bank, even for a lowly position, they require you to have a college degree.
They might require, but you know, that is undemocratic. Let the people determine and decide whether they want a college degree holder or one who could only read and write.
I see. In other words, what you're saying is let the people decide if they want to vote for the college degree holder or not.
Yeah, that should really be. That is the most democratic. The other one, the running in tandem, you know.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I tend to agree with that. Mm. I was going to ask you, it's like that in the U.S.? What's wrong with that?
No, what is wrong with that is this. The president and the vice president would run as a team.
Yeah.
And the vote for the president would be a vote for the vice president.
So they can
but
work
under
together?
The, no, under the draft, a vote for the vice president will not be a vote for the president.
Really?
So, it is in the draft itself. It
That's
is only
in the fine
a vote
print.
For the president. It is the draft would only saying a vote for the president under the team proposal. A vote for the president will be counted as a vote for the vice president.
Okay.
But nothing is mentioned about a vote for the vice president to be counted for the president.
Because
but
is,
Because
isn't that quite obvious? I mean, when you're a tandem, technically as a voter, you are voting for the president.
No, not necessarily. Because here, my opposition is this. It will now prevent the entry of independent candidates.
Mm.
So how can you run as an independent president if you don't have a teammate? How can you run as a vice president if you don't have a teammate president? Remember, Nolly De Castro won as a vice president.
Yeah.
Running as an independent. That will not come to pass anymore.
So, but the problem is you do have, if the president and vice president aren't from the same party, which I was wondering, I found it problematic in the Philippine setting. They don't work together. You have the president kicking out the vice president, no position in cabinet, not giving him or her a budget. It's not efficient for government too.
That is a very efficient one. As a matter of fact, that may be helpful in a democracy.
Yeah.
Because somebody will always counter-check.
Mm.
The vice president will do that.
Okay. But isn't it a wasted position if they don't work together?
No. I don't think so that a vice president cannot work together with a president who doesn't belong to his party.
Okay.
It is only when the policies are entirely different and they will disagree. But I'm sure that a vice president elected with a president who doesn't belong to his party will work. That is the provision that the vice president may be appointed to a cabinet. You remember?
Yes,
BNI
yes.
was even appointed.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And also Larry Robredo. But when the president doesn't trust them, that's the best way. I mean, they're not in the inner circle anymore.
Well, if you do not trust your vice president, you should not appoint him to a cabinet position.
Okay. But you don't agree with the tandem.
I do not agree with the tandem. As a matter of fact, you are now constitutionalizing tandem.
Mm.
And you know very well it's the meaning of tandem right now. And
yeah,
now
but,
it will be put
what,
in the Constitution?
But what would be wrong when in the U.S., I mean, specifically just for the tandem, it's like that?
You mean when?
In the U.S. I mean, you do have Trump with his vice president.
No problem with nations where you have strong political parties.
I see.
Because it even may be mandated that one party, like the Republicans, must have a candidate for vice president belonging to the same party.
Okay. CJ, you questioned also the draft charter's failure to mention specifically the words West Philippine Sea in provisions on national territory.
Yes.
Okay.
You have a provision on Article 2, Article 1, national territory. There are now two sections compared to the previous constitution, only one section.
Uh-oh.
Because it should be general. But this time, it will be two sections. The section two will now include a specific mention of the Philippine rice. And that is not even necessary.
Yes.
Because we have it already. We have historic title to it. But it forgot to mention clearly and specifically the West Philippine Sea, which is highly controversial.
Which in the 1987 Constitution is clear.
Not clear. No, but there is a mention of West Philippine Sea.
Yes, yes, yes. That's what I was going to say. Yeah. So what would the implications be if it's not mentioned?
If it is not mentioned, that will give already some credence to our suspicion that it is in favor of China, showing either our love for China or fear of China. And we have indicated, I have indicated, the various situations to prove that we are being getting closer to China. This morning you mentioned about the envoy saying the Philippines will never be a province of China, but no less than the president himself. Last 19 of February 2018, before the Chinese businessman in Manila Hotel, said that the Philippines can be a province of China. Okay? The envoy says it will never be a province. So what is in the mind of the envoy? The envoy is saying, you will be our colony. So now, the latest is you have a research vessel landing in Davao. Earlier, you had, on two occasions, Chinese military airplanes landed in Davao.
Yeah.
And so we have several statements by the president indicating our closeness to China now. As a matter of fact, our businessmen, the real, genuine businessmen, are even afraid of the entry of China.
Okay, I wanted to ask you, is the president, could he be possibly violating the 1987 Constitution with all the either actions or inaction he's done in relation to China protecting our territories?
Many have made certain opinions about that. I cannot express my opinion. I only would say that under the Constitution, the president took an oath, a solemn oath. And one of his promises in the oath is to preserve and defend the Constitution. So I will leave it to any scholar to find out, and to those who are more knowledgeable, to find out really if there is the possibility of looking at the idea of an impeachable ground.
Okay.
Yes, but okay, that would be meaningless anyway.
Okay.
It cannot be initiated in the lower house. It is super majority.
Okay. All right. Now the Bill of Rights. You do have some who have said the Bill of Rights under the draft federal constitution is far stronger than the 1987 constitution. I have it here in terms of civil political rights. There's social and economic rights. Okay, can we show that on graphics? Mm-hmm. There's also environmental and ecological rights already detailed in the federal constitution, which was not in the 1987 constitution.
Not
is
detailed,
this stronger?
Yeah. Not detailed in the present constitution, but actually covered in the present constitution. For instance, on social justice, economic and social rights, you have the whole article on social justice and human rights. You have the enumeration. These enumerations are not really needed. What happened is, although they claim it is expanded, in fact, it has reduced certain rights.
Really?
Yeah, okay.
Wait, you're the first one who said this. Okay, yeah. I want you to explain.
Okay.
So what you're saying is the Bill of Rights under the draft constitution was even reduced.
It's even reduced. Some rights are even reduced.
Like what?
Yeah. For instance, the best example is about our right to privacy. Privacies against unreasonable searches and seizures. Right now, under the Constitution, there are only one possible way, a search warrant. This time, they have added a surveillance warrant. So in other words, if the authorities will not have enough evidence against you, and they are ready for a search warrant, the court, on application for a surveillance, may be able to obtain a surveillance warrant and install certain gadgets, electronic gadgets.
In your house?
Not necessarily in your house, but somewhere outside to cover your house.
I see.
So, surveillance warrant. Imagine. And So I'm so scared about it.
That's quite interesting. So what you're saying is technically, they've lessened privacy rights.
In fact, it has.
Yes.
And then, another right, for instance, that is being endangered, although not necessarily in the Bill of Rights, but supposed to be in the Bill of, supposed to be in the Declaration of Principles, the state no longer guarantees, as mandated now in the Constitution, full respect for human rights. Nothing is mentioned now in this draft article.
Yeah, but what if CJ Puno tells you, yeah, but you know, that's quite obvious. It doesn't have to be said.
It cannot be obvious. As a matter of fact, they try to enumerate certain rights when actually it can be done within the context of our present Constitution.
Okay. So what you're saying is they did not mention, what was that again, the phrase, human rights? You said it.
Full guarantee the state shall shall promote and protect, shall guarantee respect for human rights. Yeah. Full guarantee for human rights. It's no longer there. What they say is human person. But that is not necessarily so, because you have to distinguish between the person and the rights.
What are the implications of that, given right now with the war on drugs, EJ case?
The implications would be that we have actually reduced what are the guarantees provided for in the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. Now, they have an additional claim that they have expanded, because Section 1 now of their Bill of Rights provides that the rights herein enumerated are demandable against the state or non-state actors.
Yeah. In other words, you can sue.
You can sue. Now, under the Bill of Rights that you have proposed, you can recover damages for violation of certain rights. But yet they have forgotten to also amend the provision in the general provisions regarding the state being immune from suit. So how can you recover against the state for damages, for instance, for violation of your rights under the Bill of Rights, if the state cannot even be sued?
That's quite...
So you have.
So it says
there... But it can be sued with the consent. The provision is the state cannot be sued without its consent. And so if you claim for damages against the state, it cannot be done unless the state will consent.
And normally they won't. Why would they?
Because of the non-suability of the state.
Yeah.
So right now you can file damages against anyone claiming violating your human rights. For instance, against unreasonable searches and seizures. You can file a case against the policeman. You can file a case against an ordinary person who might have participated in violating your rights.
But then now, if this is passed...
Well, if it is passed, you still have to get the authority of the consent of the state, but not as against the so-called non-state actors. But that is not necessary, because for every right, there is always a corresponding obligation. And so if you disregard the right of the others, you can recover already. So that provision is not necessary anymore. Against the right to life, for instance, if somebody will kill you, your heirs may be able to recover damages against the opponent.
Okay. When you've read the draft in full, what do you feel or see as its biggest flaw?
The biggest flaw here would be really that what I stated, that what is created actually is a weak democracy with ingredients of totalitarianism and fascism. It is a weak democracy because the protection granted to it would really be inequality. And then you have massive restructuring of the entire machinery of the government.
I was going to say, and for the declaration of martial law in the new federal constitution, they added a ground. And the ground is lawless violence. Do you see that as...
I attacked that yesterday because I said it will now give another ground for the declaration of martial law. Because lawless violence has never been defined. But rebellion and invasion are defined in the revised penal code. So the president can just simply say, I have declared now, I have found lawless violence. And who can tell him that is wrong? He has the police, he has the military. The military will support that there is lawlessness. as a matter of fact, almost everybody is now claiming that we have a culture of lawlessness.
Okay. Now, the anti-political dynasty provision. Some have said that the federal constitution is stronger in that way, that it's actually specified, you know, that in terms of anti-political dynasty, you would give ordinary people a chance to run because it bans.
Well, the fact is, under our present constitution, you have a declaration of state policy regarding banning political dynasties. But the provision leaves it to Congress.
Okay.
It is not self-executory. You know why? As a matter of fact, in the 1986 Constitutional Convention, a commission, I was the first to make a proposal regarding anti-political dynasty. But I think it was principally Commissioner Ople who said nga, we should not put it there in the Constitution, the definition, rather the limits already. Because you have to leave it to Congress and it is much better. Because later on, Congress might decide probably to widen the scope of political dynasties. If that would be so, you have to amend the Constitution. But it is better if it would be in a law. You could amend it at any time.
Okay.
So that is the reason why it was left to Congress. But Congress didn't act on it. No, that's the whole trouble.
Because of self-interest.
The fact is, under the first Congress, under the new, under our Constitution now, the Senate did pass. It was Butch Aquino who submitted a resolution, a bill for anti-political dynasty, and it was approved by the Senate at the time under President Senator Salonga. So it went down to the lower house. Well, it died in natural death.
Now, isn't that a plus in the draft?
Well, to me, it is a plus in a sense that the limitation is up to the second degree of affinity or consanguinity. But we know that our politicians are very bright, astute. They can go beyond the second degree or the third degree, say family, and then retain the political dynasty again. As a matter of fact, it is a meaningless provision if it is limited only to the second or third degree. Because they say you cannot run for a public office national level and then your daughter or son or wife another level. Yesterday, I really appreciated the question of Senator Bam Aquino. Because right now, we only have two national positions, the president and the vice president. You have regional, but that is not national. You have local. Now, interestingly, if your son will run for governor, and that is the local, the father can run for another layer, for another level. So, what will happen will be...
No, but then in terms of local, I think the question is, at least if the father is mayor, you won't have the son as...
But that is meaningless. Because the father mayor may appoint, may have another running mate belonging to the third generation, which is no longer within the second degree.
I see. Yeah. And it's still a relative.
It's still a relative, but beyond the second degree.
Okay.
So if they are really very sincere about abolition of political dynasties, they should have go beyond, up to the fourth degree.
Really?
But that could be.
But then you'll have senators who'll say no one will be left running. Till the fourth degree, you feel if they were sincere.
It is to be serious about it. That's why I maintain that it is better that simply provide for an anti-political dynasty law. Congress should implement now the provision of Section 26 of our Article 2 on political dynasties.
All right. Now, what is the role, before we go, of the Supreme Court in all this? Of course, right? You do have Congress that's pushing for a change, but someone at some point will bring this to the Supreme Court. What can the Supreme Court do? What's its role? Or is it completely hands-off?
No, the Supreme Court will still have a role.
Okay.
Because there are many cases still cognizable by the proposed Supreme Court with a reduced number of 9. You still have the Constitutional Court now. Many of the functions of the Supreme Court now on constitutional issues will be thrown to the Federal Constitutional Court. But right now, especially in the matter of this draft, some people may go to the Supreme Court later when it is acted. For instance, should it be con-con or should it be con-us?
Yes.
If it would be con-us, for instance, the issue is the Senate will not participate. So somebody will go to the Supreme Court to compel now to request for a decision that the Senate can be compelled to be any con us.
Yeah.
Or in the matter of voting.
Yeah.
Somebody might go up to the Supreme Court now to compel the Senate to join in a voting, in a joint voting,
yeah,
not separate voting.
And the Supreme Court then can clarify exactly what the role of the Senate is.
That would be probably the time whether the Senate should be compelled to join a con us or should be compelled to vote jointly. So these are the issues. But I know that even in the last hearing that we had in this public hearing of the same committee of Francis Kiko Pangilinan, there was a decision already that the Senate will be against a con us, and that the Senate, if there will be a con us, will vote separately.
Okay. All right. My last question is, 46%, was it 46% of Filipinos in the latest Pulse Asia survey showed that they are not for federalism. And then you have no less than Secretary Pernia of the NEDA was quoted that a change in government to a federal system would wreak havoc on the economy. So you already have, you know, these indicators out there. And yet you still have the government insisting that it is the best way to even out and make certain provinces or towns much richer, so it's not centralized to Metro Manila.
That is really an argument which could not be supported by fact later on. Because the moment you put up the regional federated regions, there, most of the funds will go to maintain the federated regions. So what will the local government units receive? Only the trickles, the fragments. But right now, as a matter of fact, I mentioned yesterday that all the reasons given to support federalism had been demolished by the Supreme Court itself. The Supreme Court decided that in the matter of the just share of the taxes, no, the income from taxes, it would not only be limited to the internal revenue, where the local governments would only get 40% and the central government would receive the remaining 60%. The local government units now, according to that decision, would receive all the shares, not only for internal revenue, but all forms of national taxes. So as computed by no less than Secretary Dominguez, as appearing in the issue of the Philippine Star Yata yesterday,
yeah,
1.5 trillion pesos would be payable to the local government units by the national government if you follow the decision. This decision, therefore, practically strangled this movement now for federalism. This is the best answer against federalism.
Yeah.
So I said, this is a mortal blow against federalism.
Okay, all right. Okay, with a correction, 67% actually was against a charter change. My mistake. Thank you for that. Former CJ Hilario Davide, CJ, I want to thank you for coming to the show. Do you have a message for President Duterte?
Well, my only message to His Excellency will be that we need unity, solidarity this time. And, this chacha has divided our people. So I hope that during the SONA, instead of telling the Congress to approve the draft constitution by both houses, that he would announce that for the sake of our country and our people, for the sake of our unity, there will be no chacha during my term.
On that note, what a great ending coming from you. Replay of this interview is 10:30 in the morning. It's also available on iwanttv.com.ph, ANC Facebook page and Twitter page. Market Edge is up next.